What is going on, ladies and gentlemen? I am BDLM, coming with my buddy J4Y, bringing you episode number 97 of our Dota On Demand podcast. I have returned.
He's back!
I may have spent an amount of money. You can't prove it.
It wasn't free the whole trip?
You can't prove it. I'm really hot in this, actually.
Oh, God, can I look yet?
Yes.
Here we go. What did you do?
Accrued a number of items from the secret shop. I just strolled my way over there. And, okay, so the great thing is, here's your TI story number one. I got up to pay for my things at the secret shop, and I jokingly asked the lady if I could trade her my firstborn, and she just looked at me and said, yeah, we'll take him.
Whatever you got.
Slark's good. Yeah, anyway, how are you doing, buddy?
Oh, doing pretty good, man. Doing pretty good. Not as overheated as some people right now. Actually, I am really warm, and I want to put my fan on, but to spare the audience, I shall just stay really hot. Doing good, though. Finally excited to talk about this. As people will know, if they've kept up with the Facebook or the Twitter, we delayed the episode, unfortunately, due to BLM just feeling really under the weather after traveling. He actually felt really sick, apparently. So, yeah, we decided it'd be better to just have him, you know, 100% ready to go. That way we have some awesome conversation, and it's not like a drag or anything, and he doesn't, like, just pass out and die on camera, because that could have probably happened.
I feel like there was a movie that was actually just about, like, people dying on camera, and it was, like, a horror movie, and I think it did okay, actually. So maybe people are into that. I don't know. But, yeah, I caught death while I was out in Seattle just a little bit on my way back. So thank you all for joining us the slightly delayed episode.
Yes.
But, yeah, it's going to be great. We have a lot of stuff to talk about. We have a lot of thanks to get out of the way before we get into the meat and potatoes of the episode.
Yes.
First of all, thanks everybody who's registered on the website, because it's been a pretty good turnout there so far. The other stretch goals could use some work.
Yeah. Let's and they're really exciting, too. Let's be honest. All three are cool.
We actually did a really bad job with the stretch goals, because I think the idea was to make it so that you guys wanted it more than we do. But I am so excited for those that it's just unbelievable. I'm gonna have to turn it up a little bit. For all of you lovely people who have done the registered user for our website, we're gonna have a registered user only vote on the site for which hero I'm going to be. I'm going to give you some personas for the board game night, where if you guys aren't aware of the Dota On Demand stretch goals to celebrate the launch of our website by episode 100, you have to come meet some goals, whether it be liking the Facebook page, following us on Twitter, or registering on the website. One of them, which I believe is the Facebook goal, is that we will RP Shadows over Camelot, and we'll have to make our own crappy cosplay and have our own hero identity that we make up. So far, what I have for you all to vote on for the choices, one is female, of course, which will make you all just, like, second-guess your life and God and the meaning of the world.
Oh.
Because I'm just going to do just that good of a job. or the neckbeard knight. Or there's going to be some sort of just fantastical wizard. Of course, all of these come with their own voice. So, you know, just drop by the website, get registered now so you can be a part of that vote, and then, you know, you're also going to have to get people to go to the old Facebook and like the page so we can actually make these stretch goals happen, because I'm so excited. They're going to be so much fun.
I'm going to dress up as a wizard as well, and what that will involve is wrapping the blanket around me and calling it a robe. How does that sound? Does that sound pretty good?
How about you at least, like, wear a party hat or something and pretend
wizards
that that's
don't
your
wear
wizard
party
hat.
Hats?
They wear the pointed caps. The
it's
hats.
Never a party like when you have so much power.
With I think great, it's always a
with
party.
Great
when you
party comes power. Great responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to give an update. You said we have a lot of viewers, or users rather. We are up to 38.
Yeah.
Which is over half. You guys are 12 away from a stretch goal. I think that's pretty awesome. You guys have really came out and supported us, and we really appreciate it in such a short time. But like you said, the other one's a little lacking, and that's fine. But, you know, if you guys want this awesome content, believe me, we want to do the awesome content. Like, we're stoked to do both the Ogre Magi as well as this game night. But we're going to need your help to do it, you know, because we got to get ourselves to a position, and you're going to help us do it. So we really appreciate everyone who's so far reached out and joined us. But, you know, if we could just do that a little bit extra, that'd be amazing. So,
yeah, and we know there have been some issues with the website. Like, we had an auto-updater that broke on us, and I know some people had said that the site was responding a little bit slowly. So we're still working out some of the bugs. But, you know, it is a small group. We're not quite Google size. We're not Skynet quite yet. We're working our way up.
Yeah.
But if you guys can just, you know, hang out with us through us working out those kinks, yeah, we're going to make it great. But
I also have a lesson of the week.
Okay.
Because this will involve some shout-outs as well. Mm-hmm. The lesson of the week goes to one of our viewers, who unfortunately, I remember, if you guys recall, we were saying one of our amazing, gracious viewers, Ozean. Ozean.
This poor guy.
He's such a generous soul, and we butcher his name. Either way, was giving out a ticket because he was no longer able to attend. And so we actually had a viewer come in contact with us who said, yeah, I'm in the area, I'd love to go. So I went back and forth with both of them separately, and Ozean's like, yeah, man, tell him my Steam info, and I'll get him set up. So I messaged the guy back and said, you know, hey, here's this guy's Steam info, let me know how it goes, I hope it all goes well. And then I messaged him just recently and said, hey, man, were you able to get it going? He's like, oh, I must have not gotten a notification. I never knew you messaged me back. I thought it was given away. So the story is, check your messages because it's so unfortunate. I'm really hoping that ticket found its way to a home, a happy home somehow. Like, he was able to give it to someone else or something. But either way, it's a little unfortunate. We were able to just miss a little bit, but... oh, well, maybe there's always next year, right?
I may be rubbing some salt into the wound with the rest of this episode and telling you what a great time I had at the International. Mm-hmm. I have, like, so many shout-outs to give. Michael, who I actually met in line, waiting to get in the VIP line because we're both really cool kids. And then also Calvin, and then Mike from our booth, gentleman scholar. So Calvin... on the Facebook, he goes, hey, let's hang out. I'm here. We should get drinks or something later. I'm like, yeah, Calvin, absolutely. Here's where I am. You come by. You let me know when you're here. And we'll, yeah, let's hang out. So I'm, like, already a couple deep, I have to say.
Wait, you drink?
Sometimes on occasion. I'm sitting on my phone. I'm playing, like, you know, 2048. I got the Dota on a Man shirt on because I just wore it every day and rinsed it in the sink at the hotel.
What a trooper.
To keep it clean. So this guy comes up to me and goes, hey, man, do you know how the meat and potatoes are here? And so I look up, and about 2 seconds later, I just go, no, man, I just got a drink here. I have no idea what's...
you suck!
I have no idea what's going on. And the gentleman that he is, Calvin, just completely hides the fact that he had to have been thinking, like, is this guy retarded?
Like, not he's like, this is not BDLM. This is someone
in my
else.
Defense, meat and potatoes is your
it's true. Thing. That's my thing. Yeah.
But then he just goes, like, are you BDLM? Like, oh, yeah. Hey, oh. What's going on, man? What's going on?
Damn, that's funny. Oh, wasted.
Yes. And then Calvin gave me his number to hang out later, and it went to, like, the messages on our Facebook, which I can't access from my phone, and I was very sad about that. But it was great getting to hang out with you. He actually was nice, kind enough to bring around the Valve employee that he ran into, which was cool as well. So, you know, I gotta say, too, you know, the International is great for the games. I know there's been, like, a lot of back and forth about how it didn't live up to the Internationals of years past. Or, you know, other places you go and just like, man, it seems like it's a really great success. I gotta say, through all that, I had a fantastic time out there just because of the people. Like, all the people ran into that liked the show, had heard of it, people who hadn't heard of it, who were just, like, so open to me. telling him about it and handing him one of our cards, are just really great. And even got to run into some of the personalities in our booth, which we'll have to plug later. So it was a really great time.
Yeah. I wish I could have went.
I agree. It was a great
time. It was great for all. It was actually great for the spectators as well, here at home. The whole event was just, it was put on another level. It really was. I mean, they keep outdoing themselves, which is fantastic. I really loved how they also got so much more of the community involved. When I say that, I'm talking about the lesser known casters, the kind of up and coming. They let them cast all those group stage games, like Kodagai, Mott. They also had the multiple streams, like we talked about before, with the newbie friendly one, and they really just brought it to this next level with coverage, in terms of coverage, and I really thought it was spectacular. Of course, in the main stage, they had 2GD hosting the whole thing, which he does really well. There's no complaints. In fact, his voice was like everywhere, dude. Like, you know all those little like videos they did, it was his voice. I'm like, what are you, the guy from a Dirty Jobs or whatever? Mike Rowe or whatever, whose like, voice is just in the background of literally every commercial?
Or Morgan Freeman.
Ah, yes, those are the two, I think. But, I don't know. Did you enjoy, the commentators, the casters, and, the whole stage presence?
I did, we actually were lucky enough to have gotten a suite. I was one of 30 people, and it was actually really kind of unfortunate, and it's, a pet peeve, I tried to get past it, but it was kind of obnoxious at the time. They didn't know what to do with us because the guy that organized this whole suite went outside of the Valve, I guess, or the way that people normally buy tickets. He just went through the actual arena, the place, to get it. So people had no idea what to do with us. We wound up having to carry around tickets and wristbands. There is a little L bracket that sort of goes from the steps to the ring that goes around the arena to get to the actual suites. And there's no way to get onto this L except from the ring or the steps, where they had a person on each end checking for tickets and wristbands. So you would go past one person, and then there's physically no way for you to get up there except having to go past the security person. The person was like, "Heh, let me see some ID, sir." Wristband.
You don't recognize me?
We're going to need a little bit more than that.
I'm BDLM, don't you know who I am? Oh, sorry, only those with meat and potatoes get to pass. You'd be like, oh, guess I don't have any. Guess I'll go home, I guess.
I don't know what that means. So that was a wee bit obnoxious. They wouldn't give us swag bags. They were like, none for you. We got some, don't worry. We had our ways.
Uh-oh.
Eventually we got some. But the whole setup of the arena I thought was really great. You had the Juggernaut Lounge, which I believe they showed, through the TV that they were streaming out. They had the workshops for people that were interested in seeing how cosmetic items were made, which was really cool just to see that aspect of it. Not only just getting people introduced to competitive Dota if they had never been before, but also to this other side of the game, which, if you're buying some of the things are put into the workshop, you're getting some of those cards with the key codes to get some of the cosmetics that people have been working on.
Mm-hmm.
It was just cool to see how that all came together. And then, as far as the actual coordination of the event, there was this one light that was just, focused directly at our suite, which made me go insane, mostly. But aside from that, it was great. You could see, all the guys down there at the desk doing their awesome analysis. You could see the commentators. It was kind of nice, like you said, it was mostly your Toby, your Cinderin, Lumi, and LD doing the actual commentary in the game for when you got to the main event. But I think it was nice. You had that sort of your steady top tier, the cream of the crop, if you will, doing the main event games, while you still had all that opportunity for up-and-coming casters to get their names out there for the group stages.
Yeah, I mean, I know they were hungry to do more as well. I saw them tweeting out afterwards, I wish I could keep going. But, it's understandable. They're not quite there yet in the scene. And, on an event as big as this, and, as much as on the line for Valve here to make sure it's successful in every way possible, you don't want to put in someone with not a lot of experience, especially in an event like this. You want to make sure, Toby and Lumi and all these people that you've put on the stage, they don't crack under pressure. They're very used to it and comfortable, and it just makes a lot of sense that they put them in that position. But Either way, like I said, I was just really glad to see them all involved. You know, Shiver was involved heavily this year, which was really cool. Because I believe last year she just was, like, interviewing or something. She wasn't really involved too much in the other parts of the scene. So that was really cool to see her. She did a great job as well. I mean, they all did. I can't really say any of them really kind of faltered or anything. They all did a wonderful job. And, I believe I tweeted out, you sent me a photo early on from your guys' view from the booth. That was spectacular. I mean, that was, you know, we were kind of worried when we were talking about, like, how's the sound going to be? Are they piping it in? Like, how's the view going to be from all the way up on that booth? You know, how's it going to compare to a ground seat? But I don't think I would have complained if I was in that spot.
If I had to, right? I felt a little far
Which I guess you do.
Away.
Yeah.
I mean, but we had our own bathroom, so it was like, you take the bed, and
yeah,
then
that's
you
a really
realize...
good.
And then you realize that you have your own bathroom when you learn to live with being a little bit far away. But yeah, actually, it was one of the first days we were there. I go up to the booth and I walk past somebody and go sit down and I look over and it's a seemingly familiar face. This nice lady sitting there, mm-hmm. just minding her own business, just like has a notepad out, like jotting stuff down. Just like, I'm about 95% sure that's Shiver sitting right there.
That, like, blog girl that's taller than me, I'm not sure. Well, it'd be taller than me.
Yeah. Like, hey, how's it going? And she, like, remembered being on the show and everything. But I have to say, like, the one thing that I really give a lot of credit to all the people that were involved is just, like, the amount of, like, they were at work, you know, which I feel like is hard because, yeah. you know, I was there and was trying to, like, you know, support Dodon Man, was, like, giving out cards, telling people about it. But at the same time, it's like, man, I just want to sit here and watch games. And Shiver was sitting in our booth for a while, and she was just there with a notebook, taking notes. And she was like, yeah, I just, you know, I'm going to be on the analysis desk later. I just want to, you know, make sure I don't say anything stupid or, you know, like, make sure I have good notes and stuff. You know, Zayori came up into the suite and was talking about it. I was like, yeah, I was just down there. You know, people are, like, asking for autographs and stuff. Like, my wrist is killing me. Like, I have to escape and, like, doing all this other stuff. So it was, you know, as well as Shane, who I know, like, we didn't actually get to meet up because he was running around mm-hmm. trying to get things going. And Sir Action Slacks, if you guys don't know who he is, you got to go YouTube, Google him right now. Reminds me a lot of, like, Shane and Pyrian.
Mm-hmm.
He was there on a general admission that he got through doing, like, Kickstarter from his fans. And he was just working the whole time. He is a really great guy. Gino Beam was able to sneak him up into our suite, and it was cool. Like,
wait,
just
through the two layers of security,
through the double security.
Dang!
So, you know, it was just really, I guess, sort of opened my eyes that, like, you know, so many of these people that go there are there to do work, and they put in so much time and so much energy, so much effort into this to make it what it is. So, you definitely have to go out there and support all of those aforementioned names, as well as all the people I didn't mention who. Did it. Cinderin was actually in our box the last day, and he just looked like
exhausted.
He was just he looked tired and just, like, focused. I didn't even say anything to him because he was just, like, watching the draft like this, just picking his chair,
meditating,
just, like, killing,
trying to purge all the
just,
evil,
like, having a little moment. And he clearly did not want to be disturbed. It's like, all right, he might not remember.
Well, those guys are working 12-hour days. Well, and ladies, I mean, Shiva included, but it was like, that's long days. And I mean, yeah, it's for something you're passionate about and you really love doing, but it's still a 12-hour day, either way you look at it. And you figure when they get off their shift, I'm going to call it a shift because that's what it was, they go home or they're not going home. They're going out, they're getting drinks, they're hanging out. I mean, they're probably staying up pretty late still. And, you know, and then starts up again at 9 a.m. And for them, it's even earlier. I'm sure they start getting ready, do makeup, sound check, God knows, all the crazy news stuff that normally goes on. So, I mean, these people were working their butts off, like you said. You have to give them mad respect for all the effort and time they put in for this thing.
I have to say, I did find it funny. The secret shop was, like, crazy because apparently, you know, last year from being in Benaroya, it was a nightmare. Actually, the Valve employee we got to meet was doing a lot of work with the secret shop. I believe he was running it, actually. And was just, like, talking about, like, the challenges of trying to get it set up. And it looked like Amazon.com in there. Like, you paid at one place, or you made your order at one place, and they had you check it, and then you went around, and you got into another line to go pick up your stuff, and they were bringing out colored bins, and they checked all your stuff through, and the first time we went through, we had some issues with, like, the stuff that we actually got versus what we ordered, but they were nice and fixed all and everything, so, you know, at the end of the day, no harm. But it was just like a crazy thing. And even talking to the guy who's just talking about like the challenges of even that place for trying to run merchandising and something like the Secret Shop and, you know, all the great work that the Valve employees did. But they had all these people that were helping usher you through the lines. And some of them happened to be some real nice looking ladies, my dad. And so we started talking to them, and it turns out that they import their attractive people. They're from some like agency that just like kind of does temp work as pretty people. And so that just sort of amused me quite a bit.
That doesn't surprise me at all that that exists. Not even the slightest.
I will also say to the effect of attractive people, Casey happened to pop up into our suite as well and was
just
talking to people.
Did she interview you?
Not yet. Next year.
She should have.
It was really strange, though, because, you know, there's like 30 dudes in their seats. And then, you know, like a couple people pop up to go say hi. And then slowly you just start to notice that all of the seats are empty. And there's just like a throng of dudes just standing around her trying to explain Dota and its finer points. It was pretty funny. You're just like, wait, where did everybody go? Oh, okay.
The lady's okay. In the room, and she's purdy.
Yeah. I was like, girl. It was cool, though, too, I gotta say, just to, on that note, there were a lot of, like families. There were kids there.
Mm-hmm. Really?
There were, yeah. There were people who brought their parents to show them what Dota is. You know, totally reasonable-looking people. You know, I feel like that completely...
don't know
break
anything about
whatever's, well, just know that just like completely break, I guess, the stereotype of what you would expect people that are going to like a video game event that they might have flown across the continent or across the ocean for. I actually did have the chance to meet some people that flew in from Singapore and were just like talking about their 25-hour flight. And it's just like, what are you doing, son? But it was just like completely. I feel like the international in general, especially with the ESPN coverage and how they actually want to continue to do that. Just completely shows you that I think that the nerd stereotype thing is dead, if not, you know, it's on its way out, if not dead.
Well, it's definitely not dead. It's definitely not dead. There's a lot of work to happen, but no, it's like you said, it's definitely on its way out. I mean, the fact that it's getting picked up, like you said, ESPN. Now, granted, the event was on ESPN3, which is purely online. There was the ESPN2 coverage, I believe, for the start of the main event, something like that. So yeah, it was on TV, and I just remember seeing on the Dota 2 Reddit, like, people posted this thing about all these, like, Twitter comments to it, like, what is this nerd thing, and like, oh my god, I can't believe this is on ESPN, like, all these people complaining and upset about it. But, you know, that's gonna happen, just because these people have, it's been such an underground thing for so long, you know, and just in the past couple years it's been broken open with all the games, you know, coming to America especially. You know, if you go anywhere in Southeast Asia, everyone knows about these video games and how popular they are. But when you're in the States, we don't ever cover esports. So, of course, it's going to be this kind of culture shock. But hopefully it will transition if we keep applying this much, you know, not pressure, but if we keep, you know, getting the word out there and keep showing how interesting and enthralling and how much also of a moneymaker it can be, I think it could continue to be something that grows.
Yeah, I'd absolutely agree with you. I mean, the first day that we got there, you know, because, you know, as we said before, we got to go to TI2. It was in Benaroya Hall. It was a lot smaller. It was for like 2,000 people. And it was really cool at that point in time to see the number of people that were there supporting Dota 2 and esports and what have you. But I have to say, like, the first day at the International 4, and just, like, you sit down in the seats and you look at just... You know, again, you had all the suites along the side that had the teams in them with the screens up. You had double screens up top so that people that were sort of up in the, like, where we were and even behind could still watch the games even if it was on the mainstream. You had the hero portraits in front of the players and the booths and everything. I had just the thought a number of times, like, ESPN, where have you been? Like, you're behind. Like, this has been happening this whole time, and you're just now catching on to it. And it's, you know, the fact that you get to see it on that kind of a scale, it really was just a moment in and of itself just to, I guess, drink that all in person, you know?
Yeah, And yeah, it was definitely cool. I'm glad everyone went out there and, you know, tried to watch it if possible through it. It was really nice. I have to back up there for a second. Mm-hmm. Zaori, mm-hmm. did you touch his hair?
I didn't.
Oh,
I wanted to.
I just can't even fathom how that would feel. Oh, no, hard is the right question. It would definitely be like...
Hard is the right question to say.
Or answer, or something, response. Because I just want to know the last time he washed his hair. It had to have been... No, no, I'm not calling it dirty. That's what dreads are all about. They don't get washed. I mean, plain and simple.
No maintenance.
It's crazy. I mean, I had the privilege of playing with him when there was like that amateur caster little tournament that happened, and I got to play Zari and What Is Hip and a couple other cool people. But yeah, so I got to interact with him there. He's such an awesome guy. He's really friendly, outgoing. You can tell by his casting. I mean, he's clearly one of those kind of people. But I never got to meet him in person, so that's pretty cool. It's pretty exciting. Did he kind of like his personality kind of take up a lot of the room? Was he like that as well in casual combo?
Honestly, no, because, you know, like I said, like, everybody, they pretty much, our suite was right next to the VIP lounge, and so, like, they would just come over to our suite to be away from people, really. Like,
that's
they
true.
were so just, like, tapped, you know, because of all the work that they've been putting in, and so it was, you know, just, like, he was a cool dude, you know, but he was, like, very, like...
Solemn.
Just calm, just calm and just, you know...
I can't blame him.
He's there. Yeah, he was a good guy. Definitely enjoyed meeting him, and I didn't get to exchange cards. It was also hard too because you want to be like, "Hey, dude, what's up? I do a thing too. Let's make something happen." But they're just out there like, "Oh my god, people won't leave me alone." And you're like, "Yeah, totally. Let me put this back in my pocket."
Yeah, that's all right though. So. Yeah, it was obviously an awesome event. We'll get to it later, the specifics and everything. We talked about the booth. So, outside the event, obviously you're in Seattle.
Oh, it was there.
Well,
wasn't it?
I hope you went to. I don't know how else that would have happened. Where was I going with this? Oh yeah, what? So you went with Gino Beam, and
yes.
His girlfriend came along as well. She does not have a video game handle, so. We'll call her R Dog for now.
R Dog.
That's probably would be her handle if she played a video game.
Probably.
I think so. So she'd be even R Dog. That wasn't really witty. I didn't really have enough time to think about it ahead of time. Actually, I had plenty of time. I just didn't. So, anyways, so you got to hang out with them. First of all, plane rides. Any issues to or fro?
It got delayed, which was really unfortunate. I didn't get back to my house until 3 a.m. I technically had to be at work the next day, but because I was also sick, I was like, yeah, this, I'm not coming in today. Peace. So, you know, it was, the flights were kind of exhausting, you know, they were direct flights at least. We had to hop a couple planes when we went out there before, so it was nice to just get to sit and fly. But it was, you know, overall pretty good experience. I mean, as far as the flights were concerned, I loved the city. I gotta say, got to see a lot more of it this year than.
No, what time and what day did you get in?
Wednesday. It was sunny.
It's always sunny. I tell you, it's always sunny in Seattle. Did it rain once?
It rains half of the time.
Oh, really?
So it's.
I guess it just follows
actually
me.
Actually, rainy in Seattle most of the time, except for
half.
Sometimes.
Except for the half. Yeah, because every time I've been, I have never seen... Well, I've seen drops of rain, but it hasn't been, like, a steady pour.
I've seen drops of individual on the
I've
street.
I've seen the drops. It's kind of like the Matrix. I can dodge
rain cloud was here.
Yeah, but, interesting. So you got in Wednesday, around midday, mm-hmm. right?
Yes.
So you obviously had Wednesday and Thursday to kind of just explore them, because the event didn't start till Friday.
Yeah, it was amazing. Went to this place called Paseo. If you're in Seattle, if you go to Seattle, just go there. I'm going to go there every time I go out there. I don't care, like, if I have to drag people kicking and screaming there. It was amazing. And the best part was, and this is how I knew, that, like, from the first place we stopped, that it was going to be great. In line, we get up to the front register, and we're actually talking with some people that were wearing shirts. So it's like, oh man, we're already like running into DoD people a couple days ahead of time. That's so cool. We're talking to him. Well, guess what? The guy at the cash register is like, oh, you guys are out for that? Yeah, that game's pretty cool. Hey, have you heard of Heroes of the Storm by Blizzard? Blah, 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 blah. And it's like, yeah, I mean, we're here for something else. But it was just so cool that you had people like just being there and having, I guess, so many people be at the event. But clearly people that lived there knew what was going on and like were invested in it, at least to a little bit. You know, the guy didn't play Dota himself, but you know, it was just sort of being a part of the esports community or the, you know, the video gaming clique. We actually, at one point when we were leaving the arena, two police officers came up to us and a little bit about BDLM. I'm from Baltimore, Maryland, and I don't know if you've seen The Wire. I don't know if you've seen The Wire, but just like 10 seconds of it maybe, and then you'll understand why maybe you'd be freaked out. I mean, just like, you know, police, it's just like, they're not, I don't know. And you just like,
they're scary.
Just you're like, why? What did I do? Did I jaywalk? What's going on? Like, hey, what's going on? What are you guys up to? We're like, oh, we just came from the thing and the stuff. And they're like, oh, did LGD win? We're like, what? What are you talking about? Do you know what this is? They're like, yeah, yeah. So what happened? It was like, no, they lost. Like, oh man, that sucks. And they walked with us for like three blocks, just talking about video games. And then we got to our town. We're like, all right, guys.
There's so little crime in Seattle that they got nothing better to do than to walk around talking about stuff.
It was the greatest thing
That's
ever.
That's awesome.
I mean, like, you know, you go to the event. I actually did an interview with Slacks, and he was like, what's your favorite part of the event? And I guess he was expecting me to say, like, all the games or the stuff. I'm just like, the people, man. The people are amazing. Not even the people that were there, but the people just around that totally, like, got what was going on, even if they weren't directly of it. And it was just really restored my faith in humanity.
The West Coast, I genuinely feel, have a lot less stuck-up people than the East Coast.
They're
genuinely
so friendly.
Feel like that. They are. They really are. Like, even like when I went to San Francisco on a business trip a few months ago, even the homeless people were nice. Like, they were greeting me. They're like, oh, have a great day. They didn't even ask me for money. They just wanted me to have a great day. And I'm like,
they gave you change.
Thank you. Yeah, they're like, you know what? You look like you're a little down. Here, have a quarter. You know, I save that up all month. I'm like, wow, thank you, dude. That was really kind. I do not take money from homeless people. Don't actually get that impression. But I generally feel like that in general. I'm not saying everyone these guys. We're from the East Coast, so obviously there's some friendly people in the neighborhood, right? But
at least one.
Wow.
Maybe I meant you.
We know you didn't. Because you're a jerk. So it wasn't you either. So, but I really do love the West Coast, and I think it's... I don't know. It's really fascinating though to hear that, like, just everyone, even not the people that were at the event, but just the surrounding, were just so supportive and so, like, you know, ready to go for the event. I mean, then again, you have to remember PAX Prime is there every year, so I feel like they have a lot more video games / game centered events and things compared to like Maryland. I mean, the closest thing we host is what I can't remember the name. It's that huge event. Where everyone dresses up, and
Comic-Con,
no.
Otakon,
Otakons.
I mean,
I think it was Otakon.
I think there are cons.
It's places. A con of sorts, and not like a heist, but like a it's a big con. But yeah, there's convicts for sure. But no. I mean, we have like that, which I've never been to, unfortunately. Well, I say unfortunately. I'm not sure I would, but it's a little different. That's not video games, really. I mean, I feel like that's just like a general thing. That was a big rant, but the whole point
is,
I feel like the West Coast has that, you know, video game type. Of course, Valve being Washington, Blizzard in California. I mean, you've got all those kind of things built up, so it does not surprise me too much.
I just, like, I guess my last little bit on that is, I think it's just this thing we play on the internet, and you rage at people all day, every day. Or you have people that rage at you all day, every day. And it's just was really nice to actually get to see all these people and make friends with people in real life. And then you realize that, like, once you get away from the screen, that, you know, it's just like people that are sitting there just like trying to figure out the draft with you there. And they're like, oh man, wouldn't it be cool if they did this? And the people that just like all get excited for the picks, or you go like, oh my God, they picked Annie Mage. It's a... Honestly, it was an event that I just, like, really made me feel good as a person and a human being. And, you know, I'm I was thinking on the way out there, like, oh man, I'm going to spend so much money. Is it going to be worth it? And it was, you know, the first hour being there, you're just like, this is absolutely worth it. And I'm going to make sure that I'm there next year one way or another. So,
and it should be there next year, according to something you heard.
Yes. So the rumor Spoiler. Around the mill on the grapevine, whatever.
There's a grapevine wrapped around the mill. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Is that they are contracted to the Key Arena now. So, we can expect there to be Dota, most likely, in Seattle for several years to come. And that I actually am really excited about. I feel like it's just advantageous for Valve to be able to host the event in their own backyard, but also because, you know, EG did the best that any North American team has done in the international, getting the third place. Awesome. You can't really expect much more than that. Maybe only two things more than that. It's just really cool that you get to sort of build this up. And, you know, would ESPN have covered it if it was in another country? I mean, yeah, I guess maybe. But it's just cool that it's sort of going to continue to grow esports in an area where it's not already a big thing.
Right. Yeah, we need this, to be honest. We really do. It's pretty important, I think, to us. And I'm not sure if League of Legends has their main event in a consistent area or not, because I think they may have hosted, I mean, obviously we don't know much about that, but I feel like they may have hosted some stuff in the North America too. But yeah, we just need more big esports events in general, because like you said, I mean, we've had a few definitely crop up over the past few years. Some big LAN events have came through, but obviously the main focus of them is still in Europe, I'd say. It's kind of been, especially for Dota 2, has been like the go-to place for LAN events. But yeah, this is like obviously the ultimate, you know, one, and it's really nice to see it, hopefully consistently there if that rumor mill grapevine stays intact. But yeah, I definitely am excited, and it also means that hopefully if they could make an announcement about that sooner rather than later, people could start making preparations a lot earlier, because it's always been like 3 months before the event that you have to all of a sudden be like, oh, okay, it's going to be in U.S. again. Yes, I'm going to start planning my trip now. Like, it's really last minute for a lot of people, and it gets more expensive with tickets, with hotels, with all that stuff if you have to wait longer. So hopefully they could finally, like, rumor grapes. Sorry, the chat just threw me off completely. But, yeah, hopefully they could come up with a response a little earlier, and that would be that'd be awesome.
Yeah, I agree. I also, one thing that I would just absolutely love this to death, if anybody follows the value of items on the market, you'll happen to notice that the couriers of this year were slightly less than certain Druffins that some of us own.
Yes, I still have that one.
In the line to get into the arena, the line in the secret shop, there were some individuals, and I'm not going to criticize. I bought like 1 to 3 things to resell, and trust me, I didn't like make anything off them much at all. But there were just people there specifically for the purpose of buying and reselling and trying to make money off the event, which was like really kind of obnoxious to me personally. And it was the coal in the stocking of this Winter Wonderland Christmas that I was experiencing. The guy that apparently bought all of the headsets from last year, the year before, that had the Scythe of Eyes, and he literally bought all of them to control them all so that he could sell them for ridiculous prices. He was there, I think somebody was saying they spent like $10,000 the first day to buy stuff and resell it.
Was he an employee of the local cable company? Huzzah! Sorry. They're kind of monopolistic. All right. It was a stretch. We're fine.
It's okay. Continue. We're going to make it through together.
We're going to go.
I actually really enjoyed that, for the most part, items didn't resell for a lot more than they're worth, you know? It'd be nice if there were maybe like a couple things. I mean, the Windranger bow that some of us got for other people because they're so cool. actually maintains like a kind of ridiculous value. And I kind of like that there are a couple things that it's like, yeah, you're here. You know, if you want that, you can say like, oh yeah, I have this awesome item. And, you know, of course, people are always going to try to resell things and take advantage of the system or, you know, try to play the market. But I really want there to just be like an overwhelming amount of supply next year like there was this year so that it's impossible. So it's like, I guess, less prevalent that people are standing there in line trying to figure out what to buy, what to resell, you know, or sitting there filling out multiple order sheets at a time so that they can, you know. I just, I'm kind of looking forward to it being big enough where it's not people that don't get to go having to like spend money or trying to buy things for completely overpriced.
So was it outdoors? Was it outside of the yeah, was outside of the arena? So you didn't need a ticket to participate?
No. It was like cut off, but it was outside.
So you did need a ticket.
You did need a ticket to go to the secret shop.
Okay. Well, that's good at least. I thought like anyone could just go in and buy stuff. Yeah, that's definitely a good point. I mean, I remember I don't know if it was Casey, but someone interviewed someone in the line, and they were like, so, how long have you been out there? They're like, oh, about 5 hours. And I'm like, holy moly. Like, they just spent literally a whole freaking day waiting for items. Now, were there TVs or radio things to announce the games as it went?
Yes, there were, a couple TVs outside. We actually, I think the longest we had to wait was like an hour and a half. But yeah, the first day the line went from the secret shop, which was outside, into the arena. It went all the way around the ring that of the floor that the secret shop was on. So it was just like outrageous numbers of people in line to get their stuff. They didn't sell out of many things, which was really cool. They sold out of the Wind Ranger shirt. But other than that, I think they pretty much kept stock of most of the things that they had there. So it was really nice that they had the volume to be able to support the number of people and number of transactions that came through there. You know, they had people there that were there for, you know, the same like number of hours per day as the casters, you know, people telling us about their, you know, 13-hour shifts. To just sort of, I guess, keep the lines moving and keep everybody cool. And even just like they would just like talk to you, just like, oh, hey, how's it going? Where are you from? Blah, blah, blah. So it was just really cool that the amount of work and effort that went into Secret Shop really paid off. And, you know, it was just really well done, I would say.
Yeah. I mean, there was nothing they could do about that. I mean, like, compare that buy time to when we were in Benaroya. I mean, we probably spent the most 30 minutes or something. I mean, it was so minuscule. Granted, the scale, like you said, was like, what, like 8 times smaller or something like that. I mean, it was way less people that were looking to buy stuff. So in that regard, it makes sense. But, and there was also, though, this year, it's just so much more cool stuff. I mean, they, like you said, they really outdid themselves with the vendors they brought in, with the shirts they had, with all the in-game items. And then beyond that, there were possibly little models or what the heck
are
those
referring
called? Oh, I don't know. I think they were things that were designed in the shape of a character in the game, perhaps?
Of a character in the game? Yes. I'm trying to think of, like, just what it is you could be talking about. I don't...
For those who aren't watching live...
You need to.
BDLM is currently snuggling up with two lovable characters, or heroes, I should call them.
Once
can you introduce us to your friends?
This little guy over here is Slark. He looks awesome, by the way. I love the little
Slark. Hold him up really close to your camera.
Oh, really close to my camera. There's little Slark. There's little... I got a poster, too, so there's going to be, like, a background in the coming days, so just get prepared for the quality to skyrocket here, ladies and gentlemen. I got myself a nice little Crystal Maiden. I also, the number of, like, cosplayers that were higher than last year, I guess there are more people, than the last time that I went. There was another Crystal Maiden. I tried to find her to convince her that she was my future wife and just didn't realize it yet. Unfortunately, I had a hard time locating her. But everybody there, I mean, there were a lot of great costumes. I think my favorite, like, just for ridiculousness, was a man in just, like... If anybody watches It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, it's like the Green Man suit, except it was blue. And he said he was morphling. It's like... You know what? I really don't know what else you would do, so... Cheers, sir.
That's different. That's special.
I don't know what actually got streamed out to everybody else, but there were these lovely ladies dressed as just about all of the female characters from Dota. There was a Crystal Maiden. I don't know if I mentioned that.
No pictures with her, though?
No. I couldn't find her. Believe me. Maybe it's the best for her, because she may have been coming back home with me, possibly against her will if I had found her. But
okay,
what's important is that everybody had a good time. Everybody had a good time.
Yes, I'm sure they all did. That's really cool. Yeah, I'm glad you guys had a good time. I was going to ask you about the cosplay girls, so zero pictures of any cosplay girls this year is what you're saying.
I'm sorry.
Oh, that is, you know, that's a bit disappointing, to be fair.
To be honest, that's what I should have done. But, hindsight's 2020. I didn't have a camera.
You guys have phones? The world, everyone has a camera.
I tried. That was awful quality. I really did.
You need, like, a normal phone. How about that? That's fine.
I need a flip phone from 1995 so I can get better quality.
Yeah, pretty much. You get a little, what are those things? What were they called? The razors or something?
Oh, yeah.
God, everyone had those except me. I didn't know. But,
everybody but us.
So, next question.
Okay, I'm ready.
What is something new you experienced in Seattle?
Oh, that's on my personal Facebook page, and that is going to be on the Dota on Demand. I tried my first oyster.
Uh-oh.
I'm just going to leave it at that and say that it's going to be up on the Facebook page. I'm going to get these likes.
Well,
today.
Here we go.
We're going to have board game night.
We are. We're going for it. Strong. Ogre Magi is a little questionable due to the Twitter not being as popular, but I think with Facebook, we can do it, man. But we did do chicken feet, as I recall, in DI2. So you went now to oysters.
Yes, I never had one. We went to a place, I figure, Seattle. It's near some water, I was pretty sure.
I heard that.
And so I figured I would try my first oyster. Again, I just want to leave it at that, just so that people come by and check out the Facebook. There were some faces made. There were some things said that maybe we all didn't mean at the time. But there's so much good food out there. BDLM in his free time as a regular human being off camera is into the food. There's a lot of it out there.
There is. Did you catch a fish from the market? Did they throw you a fish at your face?
No.
Oh my god. Well, you probably didn't buy one, to be fair.
I did not have. I have basil
garlic
fettuccine.
What is that supposed to be? You fettuccine.
Yeah.
You went to the sea market. Well, I guess it's more than just fish.
Yeah, oh, it's more true. Than fish.
I've been there too. But everyone harps on. Actually, I got jam when I went there.
Yeah, so
and it was like the best jam I've ever had in my life.
The person they lured me in when they're like, "Hey, you want to try some chocolate pasta?" Like, what kind of sorcery are you working over here? And I went and tried it, and it was amazing. But I went with the basil garlic fettuccine instead.
This doesn't sound like chocolate at all.
It's close when it was cigar. Yeah, that was my one big experience. I don't think that there was anything else.
Did you get on the pig, the golden pig?
There's a golden pig?
Oh my god, you guys, you didn't see the golden pig?
No.
It was in the market. Everyone posed with it. I wanted to pose with it, and there was always little kids on it. It was so annoying. I'm like, get out of there! Like, some of us adults would like to pose with the golden pig, thank you very much. I've been waiting to sit side saddle on that thing for like an hour, you stupid kids and your stupid pictures. And of course, they need 20,000 pictures from their parents. Oh, it was just... sorry.
You're still children. You'll have plenty of time to have cute and adorable moments. I'm past my prime. Let me get something in while I can. Yeah.
Us East Coasters, there you go. But, all right, so you did get to try a new experience.
I did.
Was there any frustrating, besides the flight, anything that kind of was like, eh, or irky, or, you know?
You know... The secret shop, I will say, they did mess up both me and Gina Beam's orders. They did fix them promptly, so that's cool and awesome. The security was also frustrating and annoying, but, you know, I at the same time, I appreciate them. You know, like, when we went, it was, like, ushers, right? And now it's, like, actual security people. So it's nice, you know? I mean, now that's sort of getting up to that level, it's... nice to say that they're really looking out for the interests of the people that are going in the interests of the players and trying to make sure that everybody you know, is safe and able to have the best time possible. Yeah, that's it. I mean, it was really overall, I'd say great. If you didn't get to go this year, guys, find a way to go next year. Hide inside someone's backpack and see if they can carry you in. I don't know, dress up as a player. There was a nice little, like, some of them came up in limos, which I was like, snap, all right.
The players?
Yeah.
Dang.
Oh, yeah. And they, like, got to walk down this nice little carpet, and, like, the people waiting in line, like, watched them come by and go in on the first day, and then everybody else was allowed to go in. So really cool there. There was also a food, like, a festival thing going on at the same time. So you could just duck out of the arena, and there were, like, all these great food stands, like, right there, which was really cool.
Did you get anything?
Yeah, I got, it was, like, an Thai fusion place, so they had like Thai tacos, and they had like Japanese seasoned French fries. So I guess it wasn't just Thai. Okay, what? Fine. No, it was just like there was nori in it. I don't know why you put nori on French fries. It was delicious. yeah, that's amazing. That's
great. Did you get to meet any of the players themselves?
Yes, I got it. Gino Beam was there collecting the signatures.
Okay, he's got a little booklet.
He does. Sing Sing was nice enough he was a really cool dude too, not gonna lie. Like, it was just like, hey man, can I get an order? He's like, yeah, sure, no problem. He's like, oh, hey, do you have another marker or whatever? And he used my shoulder. He wrote on me.
Did you take a picture of your shoulder?
Well, no.
He bet you showered me. Since then.
Nope.
Oh, well, that's awkward. So
anyway.
So Sing Sing, anyone else?
It might have just been Sing Sing. Because again, the problem is, and it's like, I have a problem because I know that all of these people are getting harassed by everybody for autographs and stuff. So like, walked by a bunch of people, and for me, like, it's cool, like, oh hey, seeing that person in person. And when you're, like, on the same level of the suites and stuff, like, it's, I feel like it's kind of weird because they're clearly there to get away from people and they didn't want to
keep them. Right.
But, you know, everybody seemed really cool. I know, like, Ice wouldn't give Gino Beam an autograph the first time he saw him. But he came back to him later, was like, hey, would you mind? And he was like, yeah, sure, no problem. Zhao 8 signed Gino Beam's mouse pad and then also gave him the autograph card.
Oh, that thing's worth a lot now.
Yeah,
we'll get into that later, but yeah.
So, you know, I know, like, aside from that, Dendi, like, was outside with his family, and somebody asked him for an autograph, and he was like, sorry, man, I'm...
family, right here. This. Hello.
You know, I mean...
Arteezy's mom? Really, you didn't get a signature from Arteezy's mom?
Did not. Arteezy or Dendi's?
Arteezy.
No.
Apparently, his hot mom came, so...
Oh.
Attractive lady.
Fact, probably.
How about Dendi's mom, I guess, since you saw her?
Dendi's mom was there, yeah. Okay. And his sister. I don't know if his brother was there.
Sister's married, I've heard.
Well.
Sorry. You can't marry into money now. Too late. All that esports money. Okay, that's pretty cool. I mean, you know, we got to meet and greet a lot of people. Well, not a lot. We got to see a few, though, when we went out. But then again, like, it's just the scale of the things. I mean, I can't imagine it being simple at all for them to find time. I mean, granted, though, teams were knocked out a lot earlier, I feel like. So maybe those players had a lot more free time in the event.
BG Gaming literally got to make it rain on the hose.
So you went to a strip club is what you're telling me.
No, in the arena. They lost, right? So they got their... Spoiler alert. They got their second place. And then they just go out on the balcony and they take autograph cards and they're just like... They're just like throwing them everywhere. Like, oh my god, autograph card! And it was like... And we were just standing like right next to them, which was kind of weird. It's like, maybe we should back out of this. Maybe somebody's trying to take a picture. But we're just like, no, we're just going to watch. We're going to be right next to them and just watch them throw cards at people. Which was kind of funny. Photobombing BG Gaming.
You get a card. Everybody gets a card.
Yeah. But it was really cool. Just to see that the players were still able to, like, you know, do their fan service. Heard from other people that were there that the people that they met to try to get autographs from were cool and everything. So, yeah, it's really cool.
We may need a Kickstarter for next year's trip.
There will be a Kickstarter. We're also going to take volunteers for camera people. It's gonna be a whole thing.
I know at least J4Y is gonna be poor. I'm not sure about BDLM status, but I'm getting married next year, which means my money's going away.
I will still be poor from this year next year.
You're still gonna be in debt.
I offered them my firstborn on the first day, Jay. Now, I will say, I don't have a firstborn yet. Maybe that kid's a jerk, and I want to get rid of it anyway. But I'm not sure at this point.
Wow.
I'm not 100%.
Well, so, if you get twins, do you give both? Is it like a two-for-one deal, or...?
Maybe just the one that comes out first.
Fair enough.
Of the stork snapsack, of course, because that's how babies are born.
That's how I heard it. Fact. Interesting. All right. Well, any other stories? I remember you said you had one more. Was that just the viewer story that you had told me?
It was the viewer story. Okay, it was make sure Calvin's story.
You told me to remind you, so here I am. You know, arms wide open.
You know, I mean, there were just like a lot of little stories too, I would say. I mean, again, just like getting to run into people out on the street that like
recognized
knew what
you.
Was going on.
Yeah, I got maybe not recognized right away. Recognized the shirt, the new pretty logo, that neck beard. You could see that neck beard a mile away.
Of course.
I think.
I know Gino Beam went out and people like, cause mm-hmm. I gave him a shirt to wear around and he was a champion and wore it around most of the days too.
Yeah. Someone messaged me on Steam saying, "Hey, I saw you guys out there." I'm like, "Who'd you see? You know, must've been BDLM." He's like, "No, it wasn't him. He had dark
some
hair."
Other guy.
And I'm like, "It must've been Gino Beam because there's only like three of us that own a shirt right now." So, but that was really cool.
Michael saw me in line, you know, got to meet him there, and he was like, "Hey, did you buy that shirt, or are you, like, with them?" And I'm like, "I'm half of them."
Well, I did buy it, too, but, yeah.
Yeah, I also paid for it. Can it be both? I'm half of the thing, and then I, you know, the purchase of the shirt, but, you know, whatever. But no, it's great, and like I said, I'm looking forward to next year. Here's the thing. I guess I want to get your general thoughts, because I've gotten to talk a lot on the event. And also, what are your thoughts on the hoopla that this international didn't live up to the internationals of Christmases past?
I hate that. I hate hearing that question. No offense to you. But it's just like it's been tossed around a lot. And it's because of the grand final and what a letdown it was. But what do you mean, wow? That's exactly where you're going with it. You know it. Don't give me that hoopla. But yeah, I just want to say that, you know, everyone needs to take it from a perspective of the whole event and not just the grand final. I mean, you're not going to have a TI3 grand final every year. It's just not going to happen. You know, I mean, obviously as epic as that was, the Chaos Knight trying to get the last second rush it down. I mean, there was so much craziness in those last moments and everyone was riding that high, you know, with going to the final game, but... obviously this grand final, and we'll get into it more, but just was a pretty big disappointment in terms of like competitiveness. It wasn't really close. The first game was, and then it kind of just swung out of control from there. Newbie doing a wonderful job, but, the whole event easily trumped any other TI I've ever seen in my life. And just in so many ways. And we talked about a lot of them, about the stage it was put on, you know, the event size, what they did outside of the event, the casters, ESPN3, the prize pool. I mean, there were so many epic things about TI4 that just blew it out of proportion that I just think that just trying to look at it from the grand final standpoint is a really awful way of doing so.
I did unmute my microphone, and I would agree.
Oh, good.
And, you know, to be honest, I feel like having watched some of the other international main events, I would say that some of the games were almost painful to watch. I remember like one from TI2 that we've mentioned on the show before that was just like, we had people that came from PAX and were like, "Oh yeah, guys, come check out Dota." And Tiny had 10,000 gold and they wouldn't do anything. They were stacking cheeses.
Yeah.
And we were like, do, please, just do. I felt like so many of these games, like, yeah, there were some quick games. There were some one-sided victories. RTZ's quote of... can people please learn learn when to buy Midas was dropped, a couple times, brought up, resurfaced from the past. But at the same time, I would say that so many of those games were close. They had really close fights. They were high action games. There weren't farm fests, really. There were times where games lulled, but not to a point where you're just like, let's do something. Like, no one was getting restless because things weren't happening, and You know, there were some high-risk, high-reward plays that didn't work out, and I feel like if they would have gone the other way, then maybe people would feel differently about it. But, you know, I'm just thinking of from, like, the EG perspective, because they were who I was really rooting for. You look at the Zai's support Ursa, like the four Ursa. You look at what I thought was, like, one of the best plays in the International, where the game two of the series where they get knocked out. You have Universe who lays this beautiful three-man chrono down, and then Zai goes to black hole two of them, but one of them is almost dead, so he repositions and then drops a two-man black hole where I think a third person walks into it. And you're not going to see... we didn't see the play from the International 2, right? You didn't see, you know, a dream coil that's going to stop people from going back and saving their base. But at the same time, I feel like because of just the way that the patch was, and also... just the fact that everybody is sort of a level at this point that's competing in this event, you're not going to see five-man black holes because no team is going to be stupid enough to stack five on top of each other against Enigma. I mean, some of those plays or some of those crazy huge moments are at least in some part due to people being out of position or allowing the other team to just seize this huge moment of opportunity. And I feel like there were certainly misplays and... maybe some bad strategy and some drafts and some lineups. But I would say overall, teams gave fewer opportunities for ginormous plays to happen.
It was a lot less Rubik, too.
Yeah.
That didn't help. You know. Although there was a lot of Tidehunter. Wasn't as much Rubik this time around. But, yeah, no, I definitely agree with that. Right. It was more evenly distributed, sprinkled out throughout the entire event. Throughout the group stage, there's a lot of cool games. I mean, there was also, like you said, there's the slaughters, and there's going to be the slaughters. I mean, if a team picks a strategy and it just gets countered in the draft or it's not going to work to fruition, then yeah, you're going to see that one-sided game. You know, not every game is going to be the game seven game of a best of, you know, it's just not going to happen. But
and I just want to, real quick, I think there were like two games that ended before like 20 minutes.
And they're both against Na'Vi.
Oh. Like, I feel like the number, like, I feel like it was, like, thrown out of proportion, like, the fact that some of the series were uncompetitive. I will say there were a lot of weird game one. Game two was so close, and then game three was, like, super anticlimactic, like, where EG get knocked out, and you're just like, really, guys? Like, how did this happen? Why did you let it come to this? But individually, I feel like the games were really entertaining to watch, and, you know... Great. There was an amazing wave that went around the arena, I gotta say, too. So kudos.
Oh, like a baseball stadium?
Oh, except people wooed. People wooed.
Woo! Like a ghost?
Yeah. And so you could hear the woo going around. It was so cool. Oh, and then Casey was nice enough to even, because the floor seats were sort of like not in the ring, you know what I mean? Like they were just like in the middle, right? So she did a front and back wave, and she just like ran and made people like do the when she ran past them.
She controlled them.
Yes, they were
with her mind.
They were her puppets.
The All-Star game. You just mentioned Casey.
Mm-hmm.
Were you able to watch it?
Nope.
So yeah, it was Team ROTK, I think, versus Team Avorst. And anyways, Techies was introduced, which we'll get into in a little bit. But at the end, the whole point, the prize was this cheese. It was the great cheese or whatever. And they literally made Casey try a bite of it. Like, the whole stadium erupted in cheering for her to try it. And so she did. And, like, they panned back on her, and she just had this horrible look on her face. Like, she was about to let it all go. And it was hilarious. That was a ridiculously silly game. Techies, though. Now that I brought it up, it has to be discussed. So, obviously, we knew from the goals, stretch goals, that... he was going to come in. We still don't know when, but they did the grand reveal. Because Arteezy said, I think you're going to like my pick. It's going to be explosive. And everyone's like, okay. If that wasn't the most obvious thing, I don't know what was. But, yeah, he ended up playing Techies. Went horrible. Oh, it just went awful. I think he did get the Midas finished or something, but it just went awful. Did not go well. But, yeah, I don't know. What are your thoughts on the Techies... grand opening, if you will.
Well, I didn't see it, so...
Well, how about in general? What do you think about the hero now that you know he's like he's in the game? They've got a lot of the work done. I mean, he was a functioning hero. So, yeah, we don't know how long it's going to be. But, okay, here's a two-part question.
Okay.
Do you like him getting in the game? And number two, do you think he's going to be put in captain's mode right away?
Yes, no. Okay. I think... I don't think he's going to be that bad. I'd like to hope.
In the pub scene or pro scene?
Pub.
Okay.
There are going to be trenches, and I'm sorry for all of you people that are there. There are going to be
some potato bracket.
There is going to be a potato bracket where techies is going to like ruin your life. But I feel like, especially because watching Dota is so much more common, and watching people stream, the ability to just watch games through the client, yada yada, people are going to learn pretty quick, I think, how to deal with techies.
Mm-hmm.
I guess maybe by that same token, people are going to learn how to play them less trolly and maybe make them work. But I'm cool with that. I mean, Suicide Squad attack, kind of obnoxious.
Bloodstone techies.
Bloodstone
double
techies.
Suicide. Well, to be fair, actually, mana regen would help him a lot. But actually, I was talking to Joe before the cast, and we were kind of talking about the hero. He said people aren't not going to know what's going to hit them, because he apparently is like a 5-year running techies player, like his favorite hero hands down. Loved him in Dota 1.
I did agree to do a techies IO combination with him, so where I go Dagon as IO, and then if they survive his attack, well, don't you worry about Dagon.
I feel like any hero can build Dagon, though.
Yeah, but you can't teleport people.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Suicide. Of course, I missed it. Okay,
yes,
I got it now. Got it. Okay, sure. But so, I guess that'll happen one game. But yeah, he was talking about the Yules into Stasis Trap. So if people don't know how the hero works, he's got a stun. A trap that once someone activates it, stuns them for, I think it's like upwards of like 5 seconds. Something ridiculous. But it takes a while to set it off. And then he's going to have his mind planted, his remote mind planted after the Yules. And then he's going to self-destruct. He says something along the lines of 1,400 or 1,500 damage will be dealt. Something ludicrous, of course. But I just... Okay, Captain Zug, you said no. So you think, even though he's in technically... He's been played in Dota 1 in competitive play. But you think just because it's a new hero that they're just going to throw him in the wolves?
I think they'll give him some time. I will say, though, that I'm really curious to see if any other heroes are added to the game alongside. Because there's been a lot of chit-chat wondering if other heroes would accompany techies into the game. The Shadow Fiends remodel was revealed. Looks amazing. And, I mean, not that I ever had a problem with Shadow Fiend in the first place. They could have kept him the same, and I would have been fine with it. We still have Flying Triangle, but we have an updated Shadow Fiend. Okay, fine.
Flying Triangle. Yes.
So I'm really curious to see what all the patch brings, and maybe when we start talking about the actual, the nuts and bolts, the meat and potatoes. God, can you say?
There it is.
Of the events and the actual Dota being played, we can talk maybe about what you might expect out of the rest of the patch. But I don't know. I think that, there are going to be people that try to play him and they're going to suck with him. There are going to be people that completely dominate other people because they're Joe and they've been like practicing him in Warcraft 3 still while playing Dota 2. I don't think it's going to be as bad as people expect it to be, and you wait a week or two after the hero comes out and everything will be fine.
I just hate the fear that's instilled in me to go to the secret shop every time, or the side shop. It's just like, it's so scary. It's like, it's almost like playing against a Pudge. You get that fear instilled and you're like, oh my god, is he here? Is he going to hook me? Is this going to happen? What's going on here? And like you said, it's obviously way better against a team that does not use proper vision and proper, like you said, techniques to counter that. But I fear for the potato bracket as well. I think it will happen a lot. Sure, the first month or so is going to be the worst of it. And then like you said, after some time to get used to it, you're like, oh, okay, we need to buy sentries because we're against the techies. We're going to just ward the lane. We'll be fine. This or that.
I think, too, it's a long time ago now we talked about like how a hero like Riki can sort of just destroy people at a certain level, but then you get to competitive play or, you know, even your high MMR and you just go, okay, we buy four staffs, we do all this other stuff to deal with it. It's really not that big of a deal, unless you let him snowball. I feel like it's kind of the same thing for techies. Like, yeah, you could play him well and you can play him probably at a high MMR, but at the same time, people that are playing at that level are also going to be coming up with ways to play around the hero and not allow themselves to just, you know, get trolled by the hero. So I'm curious to see how it is. I'm happy to see any new hero join the game. It's been a little bit since we've seen one, so bring it on, man.
I'm with you. And I mean, Earthspin Phoenix still on the sidelines, and we haven't seen any big changes to them in a while. So maybe the next patch will bring big changes to them. You know, I mean, it's got a lot of potential to try to find a way to carve them into the meta in a way that they're balanced, as well as Broodmother. I mean, all those heroes that are not in Captain's Mode, they've got to be trying to figure out ways to bring them in. Because, I mean, the hero's already in the game. So it's not like it's extra, like a ton of extra work you have to do. It's just about the balancing, which I understand is difficult. But hopefully we can get those heroes. I would love to see some Phoenix play. I feel like Phoenix is going to be a huge playmaker. Earth Spirit, huge playmaker. I mean, these heroes have such big potential, which is, I guess, why right now they're not in Captain's Mode. But, you know, there's got to be a way to balance them so they're not permanently out, you know?
Yeah, I may have said this before on the show. I can't remember, so forgive me if I'm being a bit of a broken record here. But my current theory is that they bring heroes from Dota 1 to Dota 2 when they feel like they're playable in a reasonable game. And then it's when they get into Dota 2 that they see how they actually feel on the map and then try to work them into the Captain's Mode thing. That's my current suspicion of the heroes that are left to be brought over. There are a lot of new heroes, they're heroes that have been changed recently, or they're techies. So, you know, that's why I'm also curious to see what other heroes might accompany techies into the game to see if they feel like any others are balanced enough in Dota 1 that they can bring them to the, you know, slightly different Dota 2 and see how they feel there.
Pit Lord
techies. One day. Teleport them right in on top of everybody.
There you go, another teleport hero. Perfect. Apparently Stryker said, by the way, it was IO Lifestealer techies. So maybe you have all the bombs? Mm-hmm. I don't know.
That'd be great.
Da-dun-ts. Anyways. Sorry. It was funny, probably. Yeah. Alright, well, I mean, we're not going to speculate too much on at least the heroes coming in the patch, because, I mean, God, that's a... We have no indication. We have no idea. So... Hopefully, like you said, we'd love to see more. There was an interview. One of the top Valve people were interviewed, and they confirmed, essentially, that they will be creating new heroes eventually when all the other ones are ported in. And, I mean, we kind of expected that, I guess, but they kind of just reassured everyone that it will happen. Probably, I mean, they didn't say at what rate. They didn't say how often. I mean, they didn't say anything like that. But you got to figure it's not going to be explosive, especially compared to other MOBAs on the scene. You know, I mean, are you excited for that prospect to see more heroes join the fray? I mean, there's already, what, about 110? So it's a lot in the pool already.
I mean, I would say, what, you had Oracle and...
Wyvern? Frost Oracle. Wyvern?
Yeah, was it Winter Wyvern?
Yeah, Winter Wyvern, rather.
That was, like, I want to say 6 months after
the last... And Earth Spirit was in that as well. But he just made it right on through.
I want to say it was like 6 months between when those heroes were released in Dota 1 and the heroes before that. And honestly, two heroes in a 6 month span, I'm actually totally cool with that. Because that means you're not releasing heroes to make money. That means you're maybe looking at the game, seeing what could
you're
be interesting
shaking it
to
up.
Do. And you're maybe paying attention to what kind of strategy those heroes are employing instead of just like, here's something new. So I don't mind. I'm, you know, curious to see if
more
they
hats. We need more hats first.
More hats.
Before we get into more heroes.
Yes. But so I am definitely excited about all the heroes left to come into the game, and the prospect for new ones. But okay, I have the brass tacks. They gotta be gotten to, Jay.
Well, can we ask this first?
Oh my lord.
I mean, it relates to what we literally just talked about.
No.
The DoD question of the week.
Yes.
I feel like I should drop it, as it completely relates to what we just discussed. So we need you guys. We need your input, all right? We love this segment. We want to keep it going. So we need you guys on the Facebook, the Twitter, on our website, wherever you can, email, give us a shout, what you think the answer, your answer is for this question. So what do you think will be the most influential changes in the next big patch? Will it be hero nerfs, hero buffs, or new heroes in the captain's mode?
Yes. I want to talk about the things that happened in the international main event before I weigh in on this, because it has to do with, I guess, the buffing and the nerfing and the yada yada.
Yes.
There were a couple things I was actually really wanted to get your opinion on. One, the main event, we were maybe hinted at by ROTK in his little interview. He's like, you're going to see some stuff happen. Alchemist, not even in the finals, but in some of the earlier games in the competition, popped up a decent amount of times. What are your thoughts on seeing him again?
I was intrigued. Yeah, I mean, I feel like we talked about it briefly, but the fact that he was removed. Yeah, because I remember briefly discussing it, because I was saying at one point he was the carry, at one point he was pretty much always support, and then he started getting run mid a little bit. And now he's kind of rejoining the scene, and it's not that he's ever been a really bad hero. I mean, he's got the kit to make him competitive. I mean, you know, he's got a great AoE with the reducing armor and damage. The stun, of course, could be really effective. It also is AoE, so you know, play your cards right, you can get a really nice crowd control in a fight. And then, of course, the ultimate. You know, as long as you survive the burst, you'll most likely survive the onslaught and continue to be a nuisance in the fight. And then, of course, the Grievous Greed, if you are the carry, that actually makes a difference. But also one of those supports, if you play in that way, that has the potential to transition into a late-game threat. There's a lot of supports out there who kind of lose touch with their impact as the game progresses. You know, if they don't have anything that really scales, if it's just pure numbers, then they sometimes struggle in the late game to really help out their team. But he's a hero that kind of only gets stronger as it goes, because you start getting the items, he'll get the points maybe in Grievous Greed and start farming jungle, farm whatever he gets, and really can start getting items like Heaven's Halberd, Blink Dagger, you know, whatever he can get to really join in the fight and cause some havoc. I think he could be really effective in that role as well.
Yeah, I thought it was really interesting, and I actually really liked seeing it. I especially like it against a hero like Shadow Shaman, who is going to have the burst and the shock, but this is a hero that's going to actually be able to just walk up to the wards, and if he gets attacked, he's not really going to care if he has the ultimate on. He's going to be able to punch those down instead of letting them continue to harass the tower, and since Shadow Shaman is a hugely influential hero in this patch, I like seeing him as an answer to that ultimate with the serpent wards. And that's something that in this event is the first time I feel like we've seen it. He definitely showed that he had great potential. I feel like his support being played middle, as long as you don't get Midas, LOL, or TZ. You know, a hero that's going to be able to get you an early mech that's going to be able to help you push, help you counter push, and like you said, he has a stun, he has the farm potential, so I actually really like seeing him. I also would like to know what your thoughts were on Nature's Prophet. We go from seeing Bulldog, who I want to say said something about why would you ever not get Midas on Nature's Prophet, immediately stops getting Midas on Nature's Prophet, and starts going for the Blink Dagger Maelstrom build that he made popular, was adopted by a lot of people, and then especially in the finals of the International 4, you see Nature's Prophet going for the Orchid of Malevolence quickly. What were your thoughts on that build? Do you have a go-to Nature's Prophet build that you like? Obviously, you can build them a lot of different ways, but do you have one that you would say is your generic Nature's Prophet build? And... no, it's just a two-part question, so go ahead.
If I was Sylar, I would play him a lot more often. But I'm not. No, I'm not surprised he's around. He's always going to be around, because he really fills a role that no other hero can touch at this point. The ability to teleport at any position on the map. You know, of course there's heroes like Io and, like you said, Pitlord eventually, who will be able to... But Io's is obviously on a very long cooldown and has a lot of requirements to it. But Nature's Prophet, I mean, he's just got so much mobility. He has a crowd control, despite not being it's easily counterable, I guess is a good way to put it, with either a Qualling Boy, a tango, or some kind of movement. But I just think he's going to always have that Rat Dota aspect to him that just so many of the heroes wish they could manipulate and do as well. And I think that's a main reason why he's going to always be around. Now, granted, the main way we see him has been the off lane as of, as of late. You know, I believe earlier in Dota times, especially Dota 1, he was also played a ton in the jungle, like when jungling was a thing. But yeah, he's still just as effective, just as nasty. As far as my build, my go-to build, it's not Hand of Midas. It's definitely not. I do like to do, well, it depends how I go. If I'm going to be off lane, I like to get phase boots really early to be able to kind of duck in and out of the lane and hopefully survive, because obviously he's not the best at avoiding ganks. You know, he's got Sprout, I guess, to help with vision and then teleport, but he kind of has troubles otherwise, and also helps with the last hitting. So phase boots, I think, really nice to have on him early up. And then Maelstrom. I love the ability to really increase what you do, like make it that much better. You know, he's always a great pusher with the treants, so why not add Maelstrom to the mix? Now you're going to clear waves insanely quickly and get that attack speed to really last hit towers better.
So what did you think of the Orc in Malevolence in almost, I want to say in all of the final games that he was a part of?
That was nice. You know, we've commented before on like how Blink has kind of entered his realm and how there's a lot more Blink Nature's Prophets these days. And I remember talking specifically about Blink Sheepstick, about how good the initiation was, because he was able to just jump on someone, bam, crowd control, you got him. The Orc of Malevolence, similar to Sheepstick in the fact that you get some, if you get the jump on them with it, you know, they're not going to most likely be able to escape because they can't use any of their spells. So I think that item obviously synergizes really well with that hero. I mean, he's got the easy intelligence hero, so obviously you're gaining from that aspect of it. The attack speed, he's already a good auto attack damage dealer, and that's going to make it that much better. And, silence allows him to kind of teleport in and set up that gank for whatever lane he's in, just that much better. Definitely a solid pick.
I will agree with you that I like it in theory. I will say that watching it in all those games, I thought it was just... Ugh. There were so many times where you would see this rush for the Orchid, but then it never actually had an impact or a transition. Or, you know, if you're teleporting in, they know you're teleporting in. They can hear it, or they'll see your branches come up, unless you put yourself in a weird position. And they would be able to, try to plan around it. It seemed like it was always the go-to item because you could see the potential for the impact, but he never actually made it happen. And so I, totally agree with you. I love the Maelstrom build now, and, if I'm doing an offlane, I do Orb of Venom, Phase Boots, Maelstrom.
Please explain the Orb of Venom.
Because, why not?
Because it's 4% slow.
And it's harass damage, especially if you're in the offlane and you're trying to go one-on-one against people. I feel like that's a lot of the point of the offlane Prophet Harass. It's a lot of that little damage with the treants. And, you know, when you're a hero that doesn't do anything, why not spend, or, you know, for crowd control other than trees, why not spend that little bit of gold for some extra harassment damage and some extra potential gank?
And then Scotty late game, you're perfect.
Killing it. You're killing it, son. I always felt like in those games in particular, if he had just gone Maelstrom first, he would have had split push potential that he either didn't have or didn't feel like he needed to do or didn't feel the opportunity arise to do.
Did Blink come into play for him?
I want to say he didn't get it, super fast after an Orchid. You didn't see, the Blink Orchid silences and you go,
see,
oh,
see, that's
man.
Where it would be effective. Right, I agree with you. If he doesn't have the Shadow Blade or the Blink, then he's going to have a really hard time. Right, you're going to see the trees. You're like, oh, crap, I got to get out of here. Unless he's really sleuthy about it. Otherwise it's really not that effective. I agree with you completely. I think it's really shows its prowess if you got the Shadow Blade or Blink. I think you really need one of those two to make that slash a Sheepstick. Well, Sheepstick's good in general, but I think to make that Orchid really effective, you need the jump on them.
Yeah, and so I guess I'm almost at a point now where I wonder, what opportunity or what situation would it be? I mean, they're going to be your mech games, I feel like.
Mm-hmm.
But just from seeing... Okay, if you go this like super utility item, you miss out on the ability to split push, the ability to do damage in team fights. You know, when are you ever really going to want to do like an Orchid first versus trying to do like a Maelstrom and then an Orchid? Because you're still like, I guess if you really need that silence really bad, you're the only person on your team that's going to be able to provide it. Okay, I get it, so you can get the jump. But other than that, I don't know where I'm ever going to not like a Maelstrom or at least a Midas. I don't know. Or
I don't. See, I've started liking Midas less and less, like, as a player, and myself. Like, even when I'm a carry, I also think I'm like, well, I could get a Midas, or I could get this other item and just really crush the lane and, like, go ham. And I always tend to favor going for the item. And that's, of course, it's a personal preference. You know, some people like to go that Midas and that whatever your phrase was, like, when you're ahead, stay ahead, or whatever the heck that is. And
Artosis.
Yeah, and I understand that theory, too. But I just feel like, obviously, it's fallen out of grace. I mean, you remember, literally, there was just the Hand of Midas meta, where everyone built this stupid item. And now, obviously, it's very limited in its capacity. But I just feel like I would much rather have something for more pressure early. And that's kind of how a lot of TI4 went, was, like you said, it wasn't those necessarily 70-minute 4-protect anti-mage games. Where they went forever, you know. Some of those games did happen, and Hand of Midas, of course, you know, was a benefit, but a lot of them came with early pushes. You know, when we saw more Razor, we saw more Shadow Shaman, we saw more Dragon Knight. You know, these teams are just putting insane pressure on early, and if you went something like Hand of Midas, you were punished severely for it. So, you know, you kind of had to transition into more of a early game item, and that's where I think, like, the Maelstrom, like you said, helps, or maybe Drum or Mech, or something that's going to help you in the team fight be a lot more effective. You know, I love the Ring of Basilius on him as well. You know, I think that just gives him great, helps his pushing potential drastically as well. And you can even go Vladimir's late game if you wanted to, and just help your team with just overall pushing. If you go more of a utility rather than like a DPS Nature's Prophet. And I shook my hand like I was shooting my wand or something at the time. But yeah, I don't know. I think personally, I don't even see when I would go Hand of Midas again on Nature's Prophet. Maybe if I was like jungle Nature's Prophet in like a pub game. Maybe I would go it just to like, all right, I'm already getting left alone. I'm just going to farm, get insanely big and stupid good, and then pop out with all these items and push and win the game.
Necrobook. I guess the other item that
I hate that item just because...
Because you don't like the micro.
Because I hate
but...
microing. Yeah.
Yes. But, you know, I just, like, and even I'm just looking through these IDs again, and you just see, like, okay, it's Orchid and nothing else, or it's a build-up to Orchid and it never finished. When you have a meta that's so much apart, or so much around this deathballing, and people being together, and there's that potential for the Maelstrom proc, and then you see something like Orchid that's about single target, that's about picking people off, It's just strange. And that's why, I guess, getting into... I guess, initial thoughts about the question of the week. I don't know that I want to see there to be a lot of nerfs to the super popular heroes. For instance, you know, you have, like, Faceless Void and Razor who are in, like, every game, right? But what was their win percentage? It's not like, even if you go back to when Batrider was super prevalent and he's got, like, a 50% win rate, but he's in every game, right? And changing the way that teams are having to play around that one hero... Then you go, okay, well, maybe that's a bit strong. But if you go like, oh, I have a 35% win rate in this event, even though I'm picked in every game, well, then really, you know, why would you have to nerf it if it doesn't win, like, all the time? And two, when you have like, oh, man, Deathball is going to be huge. This team's been just rolling through the competition, Deathballing. And then you have a draft that can't deal with it at all. So you have to wonder, right. Like, if you're not employing a proper strategy against something that you almost see coming, why are you nerfing the one thing that you can see coming instead of just expecting the other team to deal with it or to find answers for it? You know, it's like if Dota is chess in motion, you know, there are those plays where you can checkmate somebody in three moves. Well, nobody nerfed bishops, right? Like, maybe we should just keep looking for answers to some of these heroes, and that's why I really like seeing the Alchemist. And especially in the games where he was against Shadow Shaman, and even against Faceless, because like if you have the Chemical Rage up, even if Faceless gets to kill you inside of the Chrono, if you're wasting more of his time because you're regenerating health, then you can see that as a benefit of having picked that hero up against Faceless. And I feel like if I had seen more games where you go, man, what a great draft against Deathball, but Deathball still crushed. They made tiny mistake here and they lost because of Deathball. I would be a lot more sympathetic to nerfs. I would rather see buffs to heroes that maybe weren't as popular, or that can sort of push the style of the game in another direction, or again the introduction of heroes that aren't in Captain's Mode that might be able to mix it up too.
So buffs to Crystal Maiden, Huskar, Nightstalker, Kodal, PL, Bloodseeker, Slaughter, and Spiritbreaker, perhaps?
So PL?
Phantomlancer.
Oh, because he didn't get picked.
Yeah, those were all the heroes that weren't picked. Yes.
Yes. not to all of them. And the Crystal Maiden one is interesting. Don't worry, we can get there. Yeah, I got a little...
Yeah, you're right about the Razor. Most picked hero. 38% win rate. I mean, not very impressive, you know, but used a lot because of his versatility and just overall a solid pick. He kind of goes in any lineup fairly well. So, you know, he can be a good tower pusher, but he can also be a good team fighter against certain people. So, makes a lot of sense he was picked up. Weaver, 11-4 at one point, 73% win rate. He's not going to get nerfs. I mean, you know, it's not like he was overpowered. He just did really well in the games he was drafted. And
Hal did a great job with him.
Jug, 6-2. Does he need nerfs? I mean, probably not. But, you know, he had a lot of success. You know, I mean, it really was situational for a lot of these heroes. And I would tend to agree with you. I think there could be some nerfs that have come out for Faceless Void in particular. I'm not sure how yet, obviously, so don't ask me that. I'm not King of Balance. But, I mean, it just feels like he's so difficult to play against that maybe there could be something toned down. My idea, which I know would never happen, mm-hmm. but my idea
Make him
in my
stun
head,
everybody on the map again.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little Fair. Weak right now, to be honest, his ultimate. But I would love Chronosphere not to silence abilities / items.
Not silence abilities.
AKA, like, evasion and things like that.
Oh, like item effects.
Well, also hero
effects. Hero effects.
Like PA evasion and just in general, like butterfly. Like, just, I would love for it not to silence those things or to make them not work. I don't know that it's asking too much to have that happen.
I'd be cool if they increase the cooldown on the ultimate non-Aghanim Scepter so that if you are just trying to use Faceless to set up fights, you force them into getting Aghanims. Mm-hmm. Like, you should have to make a bit of a sacrifice, which really isn't even that much of a sacrifice. You make him even tankier, and he's still running around team fights, time-locking people.
He just needs Mask of Madness, and he'll do his lockdown. He'll be good.
And tone down the bonus time-lock damage a little bit. I'd be okay with him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think there's a couple ways they could address it.
I know a lot of people have been talking about changing towers so that they're a little bit more durable or provide less bounty. I don't know how I feel about that, personally.
Say
because
that again.
Some people had discussed what if they adjust towers so that they give less bounty or maybe a little bit more durable. Hmm. Against teams that are going to be roaming around to kill them. To that I say, if heroes are roaming around or there's a death ball forming, that means that there are heroes, that there are lanes where you can just get an experience bonus. There is a sacrifice to death balling around, and it's that you don't get levels easily. So what if you were able to find ways around that to take advantage of it?
And if the lane's pushed and you can't go high ground, then you've kind of lost a lane for farming early game, because then you're too pushed up and you could struggle. I mean, there are some downsides, I agree. And there are heroes that are good against push. It's not like they don't exist. I mean, if you're really against on that, that's going to be insane. You got Kodal, you got Treant, you've got Lich for farm armor even. I mean, Tinker for marching machines. You've got options that could at least put it to a halt when you need it to. You know, that has a lot to do with the draft and not necessarily the pushing capabilities of the game. In fact, pushing just makes the game more exciting. I feel like if they made it more of a passive game, it would go downhill dramatically. You know, I don't want to encourage teams to be more passive at all. I would much rather see the opposite. Continue the, you know, the aggression, the pushing, and the ganking. I mean, that's ultimately what we want to see in these kind of games.
Mm-hmm. I wouldn't hate some Shadow Shaman nerfs. Like, maybe you make the wards
more expensive? Oh.
No. But I thought it was one thing that was really interesting being at the event, and people were talking about some of the heroes that didn't get picked, and they're like, oh, Crystal Maiden, it was the nerf of the int that like took her out of the game. I have thoughts about that. I'm wondering what yours are first. Do you think she got nerfed too hard to be competitive?
Who? I didn't hear the person.
Crystal Maiden.
Oh. No. No, I just think she's not popular right now. I think that support heroes kind of go through a cycle. I mean, it doesn't help that since Mirana's become so popular that those heroes that support Mirana have become more popular. I mean, like I said, I really think that depends solely on what they're trying to accomplish on the map and what they're trying to do. Crystal Maiden, I mean, I'm actually a little surprised, to be honest, she wasn't picked up a bit just for the fact that she is so effective early game. Like, when you're trying to get stuff done, she's got great team fight potential. She can have the aura to keep the mana flowing for your team. I mean, she's got a lot to contribute. But, you know, I think Skywrath just kind of knocked a lot of supports out of the ballpark. And, you know, he does obviously so much himself. He provides that extra burst that Crystal Maiden isn't a burst hero, let's be honest. She's one of the few that, you know, is just going to be more for lockdown purposes. So I don't think she's too nerfed. I think she's got potential, but, I mean, are you looking for her to get some kind of buffs in this patch?
No, I'm pretty fine with her, to be honest. Because the way I remember it is that she got nerfed, and then people still picked her, but then people started picking stuff like Faceless, and you start to realize that, okay, we have a hero that's... comparatively to if you want to go against like Skywrath and let's say Shadow Shaman, who are some of the more popular supports.
Yeah.
Well, Skywrath Mage can line up the ultimate really well with Faceless Void, whereas Crystal Maiden isn't able to and is certainly a lot faster than she is. Can soul silence and amplify damage and slow. Cool. And then you have Shadow Shaman, who can lay down the wards, who is about deathballing, is about pushing, is about making it hard for teams to engage, whereas Crystal Maiden is about sort of being positioned well to be able to drop the ultimates, is a lot about getting that first blood. But, you know, when you're Shadow Shaman and you have two lockdowns too, it's really you look to that ultimate and you go, one accomplishes our death ball pushing goal, the other one not so much. So which one are you going to pick?
Right.
You're naturally, I feel like, going to lean towards Shadow Shaman. And so... You know, I found it really interesting that people seem to blame it a lot on the int, and I would blame it more on just the shift in the meta, and I don't think that she as a hero is particularly weak.
I agree. I think she does what she does really well, and that's just not what teams are looking for, like I was saying. I definitely agree with that. I'm going to bet you two commons right now.
I don't know if I have that many.
Well, you better find them, because two commons... That Skywrath Mage is going to get a move speed nerf in this patch.
5? Do we meet halfway? He got a 10 buff, right? So now he's just going to be 3-10.
I don't know the amount. All I know is I think that's one of the ways they're going to nerf him.
Maybe they could turn down the amplification a little bit. Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like if they, on some of these heroes, like a hero like him who got a bunch of buffs, like maybe if you meet halfway on some of them, I could be happy about that, because that was like the one thing that I remember Syndarin saying. It was like, look at level 1 compared to what it used to be, and now you see all of these builds that prioritize the nuke over the silence, because, well, I guess if you only need one point to be as effective as level 3 silence was before, then why would you invest a lot of points into it? Why not just accept that it's a strong spell at level 1, and that later on in the game it'll scale up fine.
Exactly. Yeah, it is a bit over. It's a bit scaled strangely, in my opinion, too. I mean, the bolt's obviously insanely good harass early game at level 1 particular. You know, you can drive a lot of people out of the lane or pressure them too much with it. You know, you see them roaming middle and just shooting bolts left and right at the middle hero and getting them to use all their consumables. I mean, it's kind of an annoying thing to deal with, and this was obviously Shadow Shaman Skywrath reigned supreme. I mean, other supports obviously got picked up along the way, but they were probably two of the most popular ones, and it was no surprise, like you said, with the meta the way it was, with Faceless Void in almost every game, Skywrath. With a team that pushes, Shadow Shaman. I mean, these things are just, they make way too much sense. AA was still picked actually a lot. I would say. And he hasn't really gone anywhere. And, I mean, that was pretty cool. I don't know. Do you like him still being around?
I mean, I'm again, you just make sense. You get the six, and then you can help counter push. You can help counter death ball. So I think it just, you know, makes a lot of sense. Yeah, I will say that I called the Weaver popularity. I mean, Hal being a great Weaver certainly helped his case.
It wasn't, like, popular, you know.
It showed up.
It was good. No, it was a decent showing. It was fine.
You know, Venomancer being pretty popular, less than optimally successful, but...
Oh, God. Yeah, that was unfortunate. That I was not a fan of.
I mean, and I'm looking through here for Gyrocopter, because I feel like while he's a hero that can be easily engaged upon, he can offer you a little bit of that counter push, dropping the AoE. So, you know, I guess at the end of the day, I still, even though that there are these threads that you can see being sort of obnoxious and maybe you could get tired of seeing in games, I am not overly concerned with them getting nerfed, because I still feel like there may be options out there for teams to pick up things for people to experiment with that can deal with it. And I would like to see buffs to the non-popular heroes and see what that does to shake things up. And that's my thought.
That's a thought you just had. Yes.
We've been going forever, I think.
We have. I think it's finally time to announce the overall standings here, at least the top few teams here. So if you haven't watched it yet, I'm very surprised, to say the least. In fact, I'm a little disappointed with you.
Oh.
I'm going to say, unless you like were on vacation or you have a sick grandmother or something, I feel like you should have watched these games. Even if you had a sick grandmother, you could bring your tablet. I mean, come on. We live in the 21st century here.
She'll make it.
But she'll make it through, probably. Newbie won, of course. They got $5,027,466.
Each of them now the top paid
esports athletes. Yes. No surprise at all. So they start from the bottom. Now they're here. Mm-hmm. Vici Gaming, number two at $1.5 million. Third place was EG at $1 million. And then DK at $820,000, and Cloud9 and LGD were fifth and sixth at $655K. So
they did okay.
They did all. I guess I would deal with like $100,000 if I had to. Let's consider that though. So Vici gave me a second place with 1.5. All the other prize pools, the first place got what, $1 million. So second place already came out with more than first place of past years. Just insanity. The money coming through this thing. I mean, mm-hmm. Fifth and sixth place getting over half a million dollars. I mean, do you think this trend is going to continue in the years to come?
Yes. I would like, you know, I wouldn't hate it if there was more starting money. I mean, the community did work, right? I feel like everybody that contributed, yay us. I'm here to see if it starts off higher next year. I mean, clearly Valve made its money, I feel like. I mean, they obviously had to invest a lot to get the arena and to have all the people there to help support the event. But I feel like they probably did pretty good. And, you know, even if they got outside sponsorship, like, it's just, I think, going to be curious to see how long it takes for it to come up to the level of some other sports. And I even, Joe, I think, linked an article on our Facebook to even say that, you know, compared to like what finals for other sports competitions are, like Dota 2 is kind of right there. Mm-hmm. So pretty cool to see already that it's, you know, as the title of the article was, you know, esports can sort of drop the E, you know, it's sports. And if it's esports, it's just to differentiate, you know, the playing field, I guess, and not the caliber of person required to be successful in it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, definitely. It's gotten there, and it's only growing, and I think we'll definitely see a lot more. Hopefully, I'm calling it the off-season, in between the TIs here, hopefully we'll see a lot more exciting events. I mean, we saw, you know, ESL 1, we saw the Dream League, we saw all these amazing events. They're getting bigger and better, and I think we're going to continue to see that trend. And maybe, hopefully, in the States... God, that'd be so amazing. If something on the East Coast could finally happen with Dota, that would be a miracle. I know it's asking a lot, but that would, like, I will go to Massachusetts or Boston, wherever you want to go. Just East Coast us, okay? Give us a little help here. You know, I don't want to keep flying to the West Coast just to see some event. So hopefully they could bring some stuff over here and help us out. But I think one of the last things we should touch on is the rumor mill. The rumor grapes.
Oh, what's the churning? The rumor grapes.
Well, some things confirmed and some rumorific.
Not so confirmed.
Not as confirmed, but we got to talk about them because we're kind of like...
We're CNN, basically. CNN now. We just talk. We just talk.
We're Fox News. We have the fact checker scroll through at the end.
Later. Later. Much later.
In like
ever.
A week. Yeah, probably not. So we'll start with Team DK here. Lanham, officially retired.
Sad
day. TI4. Very sad. Amazing. We'll remember him for his Earthshaker and his support juggernauts for years to come. But yeah, he is officially off. Mushi announced he is not retiring, but could change roles. Example, possibly a coach. So more of a rumor of what he's going to do. What are your thoughts on DK so far?
I'm glad to see that Mushi's going to stay around in some role. I mean, I feel like he's a player that clearly has a lot to offer, even, you know, outside of the game. So, you know, it's sad that they're losing two great players, but, you know, I totally expect them to continue to be a hugely successful club. And I'm, you know, I'm just curious to see who moves in to replace.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we've got potential, and this is just the beginning of the shuffle. So, you know,
the rumor mill will continue to
churn. Oh, it'll churn away. You know, it usually takes a solid month for things to start really falling into place for all these teams. And, you know, we could see players leave from one team that hasn't even been announced yet and, like, completely readjusting the lineup. We have no idea yet, but let's continue on the fun, shall we? I mean, it's only right to do so. Malsports, MSS, said he's going to take a break from competitive Dota for around a year due to school commitments. So Malsports now left with four players.
Sad days. I was just happy that they made it there. I guess it's nice that they still have four.
For now.
Yeah, for now. I mean, they have, you know, still a great set of guys there to try and take it back. And, you know, again, I feel like their squad, you know, sort of just sneaking in there, able to show that, you know, they were able to, I guess, sort of get up to that level, not make it to the main event. But I definitely want to see more out of them. Same with, like, Virtus Pro. You know, I'd be curious to see if they can add to the form that they were building in some of the preliminary matches.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think they've got some potential, too. So that would be really cool to see them pop out in the next set of events we got going here. X Sigma, if you remember them. Apparently, Bucking Mad announced that he will be forming a new all-French squad with his former teammate Saksha, if you remember him.
Mm-hmm.
And then the three other members will be Creo J, Jural, and Arbin. Apparently, been trained together for some time, and they will probably join the first tournaments under the new banner this year. So a new blood to the scene, kind of. I mean, some of these players have been around, obviously, but can't go wrong with another team, right?
Yeah, I mean, this is the time, too. I mean, that's the thing. You know, some of these teams that wound up trying to go through the qualifiers were just sort of, like, newly constructed, and they showed some promise. So I like their teams coming together now, and that's another great thing, I think, about the large prize pool is that you pretty much get to say, you know, a year even just trying to get into the main event is, like, a worthwhile investment. Like, the amount of money that you would get for showing up to the main event, you know, that's enough in and of itself. Like, ignore the other tournaments that you're probably still going to be doing well in if you're trying to get up to that level. You know, you're going to be able to sustain yourself. Or, you know, it'll be worth it, I guess, if you are able to win and play up to that level.
Yeah, absolutely. And they're also all French. So we don't really have many French players in the scene.
Are they going to GG early and often?
Only if they play against the Germany squad, yes.
Oh, history.
IG. So YYF announced his retirement. Confirmed. Not a rumor. So that kind of starts the wheel churning for IG in general. Johnny Obviously, Blitz. As you remember last year, they had some members leave. And some came back. But... you think Schwad's going to stay around for another year?
I don't know. I don't care. I just, at this point, it's just like, let me know when you guys are competing, and I'll watch and figure out what it is then, you know. I mean, they did well. I mean, it's...
They did. 7th, 8th place, I believe, is what they ended up as.
I mean, to be honest, I feel like you make it to the main event, and you should at least, at that point, you go, we have a great foundation to work with. So, you know, if you lose a player, I don't see that you'd be able to say, like, oh, we're screwed now, break up the team, disband, G-quit. But, you know, clearly Tron in the past is like, we better make results or I'm going to quit. So, I don't know.
Where is he going? That's the question.
He's going to quit Dota and go back to basketball.
That's true. I don't think I'd want to be up against him in basketball. God, he's scary. Mineski. It's confirmed that Ryan J. Quinn, I'm just going to keep going to ignore that, will be sitting out as the team's captain, and they'll be playing under new leadership. So obviously Mineski has not been like, they've kind of been turbulent in terms of their roster. This will be interesting to see if they can pull together a squad, I feel like, that will stay consistent and also show results.
I would say, too, that I think it's nice talking about some of these teams that didn't really have the opportunity to shine or weren't able to, like, for instance, Baby Knight coming to play for MYM.
Yep, that was the next thing.
Mm-hmm. I just seeing a lot of these teams that, you know, MYM, they had their chance, right? Like, they were able to play in some tournaments and they had an opportunity to shine, but you know, I really do sort of like seeing a lot of these lesser known, well, not that MYM is a lesser known organization, right, but organizations that haven't quite made a splash in Dota 2 really get the opportunity
maybe,
to do so.
Maybe Demon will go back to MYM, go back to his roots.
Maybe Chon goes there, who knows?
They're going to all go there. Dream team. Sort of. I wouldn't dream up that team, but it could happen. So as you say, Baby Knight, who went, I believe he went off to play StarCraft for a while, and now coming back to play Dota. MYM's newest member, they still have two remaining spots to finalize. So, potential, as you were saying. It's pretty sweet. Navi US, Brax, confirmed that the roster will not change. The five players will stay together and enter more tournaments in 2014.
That's
awesome.
That's surprising in and of itself.
That's awesome, though. Well, the thing is, they kind of came out of nowhere, right? I mean, like, they were, the rejects, and they, did some work in some tournaments, but they kind of weren't around the scene for, I mean, okay, those players have been around the scene, so let me rephrase that. They've been playing a lot of Heroes, New Earth 2, they played Dota 1, these players have been around, but they obviously came in, they gained their tag, the Na'Vi. Did not do so well, unfortunately, in this tournament. I'm glad to hear for now that they haven't lost Nodis Vincere status. They're still Na'Vi US for now. Hopefully they can maintain that by seeing some success in the future, but it's just nice to hear that there's some stability in the US because, I mean, first of all, our country needs it, but second of all, our dollar needs it, but, I just think that it's nice to see a roster that hopefully, kind of like similar to the other Na'Vi roster, for now, get some kind of, stability and push through and say, okay, we didn't do as good as we wanted, but hey, we made it to the event. You know, we got there, we did okay, we got a lot of room to improve, so hopefully now they can stick together, find some good synergy, and I think they've got potential, I really do.
Yeah, I am... this is also probably in your rumor grape, your grape mill.
The grape mill.
The rumor vine. Mason hanging it up, even though yes. I think he was technically only on one team to retire from, technically. And maybe the return of fear. It's really cool to just get to see, again, like you said, seeing some stability and the opportunity to build and, again, third place is nothing to shake a stick at, but, the potential to maybe have more North American representation or to finish better in the future. Now, all this being said, it's the great shuffle after the international, right? But there have been major team shuffles throughout the course of the season, so any of these things that might wind up taking place, could just fall apart before next year anyway.
That's true.
But... it is cool that we're at least going to, I guess, start the new season, quote-unquote, with some mostly familiar lineups for North America and with the opportunity to succeed.
Absolutely. Yeah, and apparently Mason was claiming that he was kicked from the team. So I don't know the details of that or anything, but
he
did not do super well under the gun.
Underperformed.
Yeah.
Somewhat.
But, I mean, that's also experience, let's be honest. How much lay experience? Not much. You know, compared to Fear, who has drastic... No, he did play before.
Yeah, one.
Once. Okay, yeah, so not very drastic. But, yeah, I mean, it's not like he was horrible or anything. Obviously, he did help his team get... It's not like they carried him completely on their back. You know, he did some decent play. But, yeah, if you wonder, what if Fear was in there instead? Who knows what could have happened? But there's no point in wondering that, because obviously he was not. I've seen Fear actually streaming a lot more recently. Hopefully he can get back to the point where he's good to go, because obviously they have a perfect fill-in once he's ready to go. But, yeah, we'll see if they're going to find another player, or, you know, for at least temporarily.
They're just going to pick up Excalibur, probably.
I heard he's a coach. Making fun of myself when I messed up. Newbie, Zhao 8, temporarily retiring from the scene. Can't blame him after that $1 million. That's a cool bill. So it's unknown right now if he's going to return as a player or assume another role. So pretty beastly player leaving the scene this year. Any thoughts?
Sad.
You know,
just sad,
I know. You don't want to hear about these players retiring because, you know, they build themselves up. They do a lot. And, you know,
He got to, you know, celebrate the victory. So, at least, you know, he got a taste of, I feel like the people that are winning now that have storied careers, you know, like, it's cool that so many new faces or young players, like for EG, were able to do so well. But at the same time, you think that there are so many players who have these storied careers from even as far back as Dota 1. And you know, still aren't able to sort of get the reward for all of the time that they've put in when they played Stellar. You know, maybe it didn't necessarily transition like into the top two or three teams of Dota 2 as far as the International Four is concerned. But I do really like just seeing those long storied careers finishing in the high places when the prize pool is substantial, like it is now.
Absolutely. No, that's definitely a good point. You want to speak of rumor mills? Our chat has a rumor mill going. You ready to hear this one? Black, which I was about to get to, who actually left CIS after that event. Apparently tweeted out pound bleed blue. Our chat is saying EG hype. Another person said, how about Liquid? They're blue too. What could happen with Black? Obviously known for his amazing farming abilities and just all-around beastly player. EG, obviously that would make a lot of sense, because we were just discussing how they're kind of missing that hard carry player, and he could totally fill that role if he needed to.
Maybe Black's my new roommate, and he's hinting at the color of my room.
Maybe. But probably not. But yeah, it sounded like, rumor-wise, they're... Who knows? It's just a rumor. But hey, our chat's starting or generating power on the Grape Mill. So
they're star reporters of Fox News.
They are the top dogs, you might say. And then Demon, no longer a member of Liquid, getting kicked out. So where will he go next is the question, BDLM.
Who will take him next? I don't know. I'd like to see him continue to play, but, you know, he'll find a home. Somebody will adopt him.
Yeah.
Probably.
Oh, here's some more rumor mill. These are the unconfirmed changes coming up. You ready?
Oh, the most fun and worthwhile.
Oh, these are the best. ZSMJ said on his stream, which, by the way, apparently he streams in China or whatever, gets like 130,000 live viewers. What the hell? I guess I'm not surprised, but it's like, holy crap. That's a lot of viewers. He probably isn't like... He's probably boring.
Okay, he probably plays Medusa every game.
Oh, then I would totally watch. Every game. He said on his stream that Ferrari 430 will join DK. What do you think about that prospect?
I am amused by it.
Apparently that would make it, well, that IG would go down to 3 players if that happened as well, which would further our argument that IG is just going to fall apart again.
Yeah. You know, I don't know. I want to see Ferrari. I mean, that's a great organization to go to. So I would like that for the same reason of, like, when we're talking about Zhao 8, like, I'd love to see him finish super well in these events just because, you know, he is truly, you know, one of the great names of Dota and Dota 2. So wherever he's able to find his success, I hope he gets there fast.
Definitely. Apparently DK, Burning and MMWire rumored to be planning their retirement as well.
No. Stop it.
They can't do it, Johnny. We that. Need Burning. We need it. We were so excited for DK going into TI. Mm-hmm. And I mean, they did well for themselves. It's not like they did awful. But we don't want these players to go away. They need to stay on the scene. You know, I'd love it to be under the DK banner or just play with these, like, Ice, and Bushi. But, you know, who knows what's in store, right? I mean, oh, apparently, uh-oh, we already have a fact checker coming in our chat. Apparently Liquid wasn't, or Demon wasn't kicked. His contract is up in July, and they're not sure if it's getting renewed or not.
Mm.
But the rumor mill says that...
Fox News says...
Not only is he getting kicked, but he's getting murdered as well. Just kidding. That was a little dark. But, yeah, Fox News confirms that. EG, rumor saying Fear may return to his position. Who the hell knows? I mean, obviously, that's completely a rumor, because he hasn't said a dang word about it.
A dang one.
A dang one. Hey, I'm trying to watch my language around here. All right, there's children. Okay. CIS, Black said that the team will most likely disband after the elimination. That wouldn't surprise me if it happened. I mean, yeah.
Especially after his statement of, like, yeah, we just didn't practice. I mean, clearly there's, like, a lack of determination and or leadership there to bring a team together to do much of anything. So why wouldn't they disband? This is probably going to sound awful, but I hope they do, just so that they can either get those players can get themselves to places where they're maybe better tapped to perform,
mm-hmm.
or just like for Black's case, I mean, he sounded pretty just like, yeah, like it sucked and clearly not the results that he wanted. So, you know, I hope he does leave and I hope he gets to go somewhere where he's able to contribute and
prosper,
build something. Yeah. And prosper.
And then finally relax. So, a reliable source, okay, it's reliable, mm-hmm. has said that Art Style, if we all remember him from the old Navi days, and other days as well, will team up with Dread and join Relax along with Dubus, Shocklo, and Yoki. Now, I don't know those three players, unfortunately, but I definitely know Art Style and I definitely know Dread. So, another possible team coming in the scene.
More Lashrak and Boots First CM, please.
God, please. Oh, yes, that would be...
Wait, no, I'm retarded.
No, you are. Yeah.
I'm retarded.
Yeah, I think you are. That's fine, though. So, that's pretty cool. But a lot going around, and obviously this is just the beginning. So, like we were saying, probably next episode we're going to have plenty more fact-checkers coming through and...
plenty more not-real facts that are facts that aren't...
That
facts.
We're always so smart and knowledgeable about. But, whew, we've been going a while, haven't we? Well, we owed it to the fans, let's be honest. We were MIA, so we're sorry about that. But hopefully this will kind of whet your appetite for a little while, at least till next week.
Where we get to talk about our 100-game spree of techies. And done by Joe, Striker OD, and he's just been forced to do it, actually, because I've decided it. And since he... Yeah, he just has to. So, anyway.
There you go.
But
continue, please keep registering. We're so close to that goal. 12 more of you guys, I believe I said. And we're at the 50. Bam, we're going to have the party. That is checked off our list. Please, the Facebook looks, Twitter likes. You know, I might even consider dropping down the goal for the Twitter, maybe 25 people or so. Just so we can get it. I'm so excited about doing it. I just want to happen. And I want you guys to want it too. Hopefully you do. So convince your roommates, your pets, whatever you need to do, get us some Facebook and Twitter likes too. We'd really appreciate it. And of course, we just appreciate you guys listening every week as well.
Yes. Also, I like to not bring this up because I don't want to plug pedal, right? But when we were in line, even Mike, the guy in our booth, I was telling him about the domain. He's like, "Oh, let me give you $5 just because, yay, people who create content." And Michael, we in line was like, "Can we donate to you guys?" Because I even told him like, "Yeah, I really wanted to be able to do like interviews and stuff, but I can't afford a camera because it just." Well, J4Y paid for a website, and I'm reimbursing him for half. Because the times are tough, okay? There is a PayPal donate. You can find it on our website, dodonaman.com. There are links elsewheres, correct? Facebook. And if you know of elsewheres that it's located, Jay, you're welcome to share those.
YouTube,
yes. So if you guys like what you see and you want to support our dreams for the production value of next year's international, I'm actually going to get off here and then start uploading the videos and the pictures from the international that, Gina Beam was able to get. And I thank him for that if he's listening. So yeah, go out there, reach those stretch goals, play some Dota, watch some Dota. We'll, see you guys next week.